Okay, so number seven, call the meeting to order. Jody, would you like to call the roll, please?
Yes. Reed.
Here.
Asklund.
Yes.
Stiles.
Here.
Fozell.
Yes.
Tim Toby is out this evening, and Adam Abraham, who has been attending these meetings and knows the continuity at this point, will take his place this evening. Also present is Village Solicitor Amy Blankenship and Village Zoning Administrator Denise Swinger.
Thanks, Judy. Okay, we have an agenda in front of us. Are there any additions, deletions? Okay. That will move forward to the review of the meeting minutes from August 31st.
Yeah, I love the water, girls.
Any changes on the first page? Any changes on the second page? Third page? I have a comment on the third page. Judy, I don't know if that fourth line down, if there should be a period there instead of just an and, or if something got chopped off.
Fourth line down.
On page three.
No, I was being elliptical. Yep, you're right. I will go back and figure out what the heck that meant.
Okay. Anything else on page three? Page four. Page five. Page six. Or page seven.
I just wanted to make note on page seven. The signage table is actually 1266.05, and I think that might have just been an error. That's part of that. Well, carry over.
So that would be 5A?
Yeah, 5A.
Yes.
1266.05?
Yes.
So it's just an error.
Yeah, just it was carrying over on the header.
Thank you for noticing.
Mm-hmm.
Always appreciate the eagle eye.
Thanks, Judy. I guess we really probably don't even need to want to wait until we have those changes before we can vote on this.
You can vote on them as amended.
I move approval of the minutes as amended.
Do you have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
And Adam, you're
abstaining?
Abstain.
Okay. We have no communications. We have no citizens. So,
here in the room.
Presence.
Spirit.
Next item then is the public hearing on the text amendments that we discussed last meeting. I think we have a full text with not only the additional text but also the deletions. As well as the staff report there in front of us. I don't know if this needs, let's go through it one by one. And I don't know that, I guess we have some discussion here on this one, don't we?
That's the number four one, right?
Yeah, for the accessory dwelling zone and structures, we had,
so you're talking about this document, the text amendment?
Yes, the text amendments.
Okay, so page one.
So page one of 1260.04 uses.
I apologize for the interruption, but I believe we're scheduled for public hearing tonight on the text amendments.
Yes.
So we're
not. Oh, yeah, we do need to open a public hearing.
Open a public hearing and close it prior to the discussion.
Right. Thank you, Amy. Okay, so unless there's any further discussion, we'll open the public hearing on this and begin by having a discussion here amongst ourselves. And then we'll take comments from citizens. We went through this last time. I know I had a comment about the 30% required per yard, but I did some math over the last 2 weeks. I'm fine with that change now.
Okay.
We talked about the pools, any discussion about the pools? Then the driveway at the bottom, item 14. And then on the next page, the, well, actually, that's taking care of the 1260-04.
Yes.
Can we just lump these all together?
I don't see any reason why it can't be one public hearing. If you want to refer to them by section of the code, that would be helpful for the record.
Okay, so that was section 1260-04.
Maybe make sure there's no other comments.
Any other comments?
On 1260-04, just the first page.
Yeah, I'm fine with it.
Okay.
So this is the one that I think is more complex, right?
Let's go through those. Let's go approve these one at a time, so in case we have one that we do not want to approve today.
Do we need to close the public hearing?
Yes, we do. So let's go ahead and close the public hearing if there's no comments from the citizens. And do we have a motion to accept these text changes to 1260-04?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
I'm sorry.
Call the roll.
I second.
That was Pinzel?
Yeah, because she was louder.
No, on the side, that's all she has. Okay.
I'm
just calling the vote, so
oh.
If you agree, it's a yes, and if you disagree, it's a no.
Yes.
All right, Pulsell?
Yes.
Styles?
Yes.
Reed?
Yes.
Esper?
Yep.
All right, thanks. So now we will open a public hearing on the changes proposed to section 1282.05, non-conforming lots of record. I think Amy had a comment here, or Denise, about these text changes.
Right, so just in reviewing this, it appears that what we'd be authorizing per code would be for a property owner to build a non-principal structure across a lot line. And it would seem that we could require consolidation of those lots as part of this change to the code, so that there couldn't be a future situation where, while it's one property owner now, which of course the draft 1282.05 requires one common owner between the two parcels, but in the future, since they're still separate parcels, they could theoretically be sold separately. And if that was to occur and there was a structure that crossed the property line, it would cause issues. So if we required consolidation under 12, if the village required consolidation or 1282.05, it might simplify the process in the future.
Do you have suggested language for that, and where we would put that language?
I suppose it could be B3 is where we would draft it.
Do we want, we could just table it and make sure we get the language right rather than trying to do it in this meeting? Or if you feel like it's simple enough to draft language, you could do so, but I don't want you to feel like you have to try to sit there and scribble down the language that would do this.
Well, we can do it one of two ways. We can either draft the language now and forward it on. Certainly we could table it. Well, a third option really is we could go ahead and send it on to council with the, this will be going to council for approval, correct?
Right.
After tonight, with a B3, requiring the property owner to consolidate the lots with the request that the village solicitor review this prior to it being advanced to council.
I was under the impression that this addition was to not require property owners to have to consolidate lots to do these things.
And you know, there when you brought that up, I realized there's a piece here that I don't know is made clear, but I believe that John, when he spoke about it, made it clear that there had to be an existing principal structure.
It is in here. That's
yeah. Okay.
Yes.
That's there. That's clear.
Okay. That's the only piece that I thought.
To sell it, they would be required to, to like replat in some way, no matter what, right? Like,
this is to avoid replatting, right?
This is to avoid replatting if there's no plans to. Sell or
subdivide it.
And that's certainly a policy matter for you all to consider. It's just simply, you know, that in the future, it's hard to say what could happen. And a generation or two down the road, people might have a different plan for the property than the common owner.
If we did what you suggest, we just wouldn't have to add this at all. I mean, that's really
right.
How the zone reads right now, is that you are required to, you know, combine that.
Yeah, because if they're not conforming and you join them, they may actually turn out to be conforming at that point.
Right, I suppose this would, if it was to be added, this would allow to expedite the process if a property owner was looking to do something.
I think that was his opinion.
And also, if you're building on a principal structure, that principal structure isn't required to come up to code with the lot line in between it, so that they're like...
The setbacks.
John was talking about setbacks and fire regulations and so forth.
Right. This proposal, to read from our minutes, top of page 7. This proposal arose out of a discussion to create a quote zoning lot. Staff has found that the process for enforcing this as a formal application to exceed the resources available to staff. Therefore, staff has created a text proposal that would grant exemption to interior lots owned by the same entity, only for non-principal structures. The regulation is crafted to allow properties that are made up of a series of non-conforming lots or adjacent to non-conforming lots to be counted as one lot for those purposes only. The language is crafted not to include a series of buildable lots.
And that's what they did from the staff report.
Yeah.
And if somebody had our packet from last time, I think John probably provided more information on it, which didn't get into the minutes.
Well, not,
yeah. Yeah, he had a lot of.
Should we make a motion and discuss the motion?
Let's take out your first rows and see what we get. He had the same language last week, last meeting. Judy, wasn't there some urgency with somebody who had one of these changes?
That was the thing we already did.
Is that the first one?
Yeah. No, I don't think that there was. It had simply come up a few times.
Several times,
so we got, this is something that should be changed. There's nothing, no one in the pipeline.
Okay.
The people here, they were talking about the minimum,
what's that?
The more than 30% of the rear yard, I think, is
okay.
Their, was their issue.
Okay. Right.
Yeah.
Rear yard, right.
So I guess I would probably be tempted to just go, what were you going to say?
You know, we have a lot of houses now that are straddling non-conforming lots, and sometimes those non-conforming lots are not very big at all.
Yeah.
And I think that all this language was saying was that in that specific unique situation, they could still do what they wanted to do on their overall property.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I mean,
it's not about
without having
setbacks.
Yeah. And ultimately, I think just as it would be with any other properties where there's multiple properties and things are built across, they probably have to sell it as a complete. I don't see how they could split that off.
Yeah.
You could not,
yeah,
if a house is straddling it, you couldn't sell
structures, and
unless you,
not
I mean, no one would buy it.
The buyers would
tore the house down.
Yeah.
But again, though, this says that the principal structure can't be that way.
Yeah.
So that means you can build a fence, you can build a garage, you can build a shed.
This also allows for additions.
Right, it just, additions, so long as
they meet the exterior portions, not owned by the same property.
Right.
I mean, would it work to just, to have language that emphasizes the fact that should this property, should any portion of this property, should this property be sold or any portion of it be contemplated to be sold, it must be, I don't know, you know, then replating must happen or something like that?
Before the property changes hands?
Before the property changes hands, replating must happen, something along those lines.
I would caution against that because it could look like a restriction on the ability to sell the property in the future.
Well, if they build something on, over a lot line, they're already restricting themselves. I don't think the language is, additional language is necessary.
You don't think any additional language is necessary? It seemed clear when John explained it, and what Rose says makes sense, but I don't, I'm probably too tired and
so
not well versed enough to know what
is your concern just the resale or?
Sure, right, that in the future the property could be sold to, or could be in the hands of, no longer be in the common ownership situation where there'd be more than one owner. One party owning one parcel and another owning the neighboring parcel.
Well, okay, so we have some options here. One way you can try and craft something right now, which I don't think is wise.
Mm-hmm.
We can table this to our next meeting and
this one, this
have
one
these
not
guys
correct.
Maybe go back and review this further and see where we are. Or three, we can pass it with council knowing this has to go to a public hearing in front of council also to pass. And pass it as is with the knowledge that they may come back to council with some text amendments at that point.
I would not go with the third option. I think we should probably just try to get this clarified here and now. So I'm not sure what we should do. That's what I'm saying. Not sure. Does anybody?
So you're not wanting us to pass it?
I don't. I wouldn't just pass it with the idea that council will fix it. I
sure.
think we should decide.
Yeah.
I mean, it seems to me Rose is pretty clear. She thinks this works and is not concerned about the questions that Amy is raising for us. I'm not sure where everybody else stands.
I don't have any problem waiting and having it clarified. You know, I would like to look at my notes from John of why we were doing this, because it seemed like he was very knowledgeable about it, and I would.
So maybe what we could do is ask for, there could even be a conversation between John and Amy on these points, maybe
yeah.
with one other member of the council present, or the commission present, one or two.
Maybe with Denise.
Yeah, with Denise too, I think. But maybe somebody from the commission can then report back and just, so we're very clear on what is at stake and what it is.
Could we, do you think removing the word additions would be better?
From a legal perspective, anytime you have a principal use and any uses attached to that use that straddles the property line, it can cause trouble in the future. There can be issues as a result of those being two separate parcels. What might be helpful, if the commission wants to table this, like you said, so we can have further conversation, we can come back with both an opinion from the solicitor on this language and some proposed language about consolidation for you to consider at the next time that you consider this particular amendment. They don't have to all necessarily be passed at the same time.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, I think I'd be fine with that. I would like to make sure that John's reasoning is fully clear in all of our minds so that
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I kind of like Rose, that thought we had, we knew what we were talking about last time.
And I apologize for not having had the, I didn't have the ability, I didn't hear John's discussion on this particular.
And that's fine, though, it's fine, but we may not, we might think that, but there's something, there's no harm in waiting.
And I thought he had some ideas about consolidation, because there are, as we said, there are a number of, I don't know how many, of owners who have non-conforming lots, and in fact have structures that are on, across the line. And it is, it costs, I guess, quite a bit for people to get it replatted. And so John was saying in other communities, that's not required, that they have a way of doing it with the staff. And I think he was leaning towards looking at that being what we might do here in the future.
Yeah, I do remember that that was the reason as to why he wrote this language to begin with, was so that people have to be glad, you know, in that situation.
And if you're going to build like a shed and you don't have enough room to set back from your interior lot line, you know, requiring staff to deny someone's, you know, shed permit because of that seems, you know, I think that's the one of the issues that we're trying to avoid.
Okay, so it sounds like we might have a consensus here that we should table this and continue this public hearing at our next meeting.
Right, making sure that we get some further thoughts and language from the solicitors that we can consider.
Okay.
And we can all look at what John said better and maybe even involved in a conversation.
Do we need a motion?
We do.
I move that we table this until at least the next meeting.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
That's going to be somebody else a chance to second. I don't get your name listed.
I think that was unanimous. Opposed? Okay, so we're square there. Amy, you're going to...
Yes, I think by your next meeting, it'll be on the, I'm assuming it'll be on the next agenda, and we'll have an opinion from the solicitor and some proposed language.
Awesome.
Great, beautiful.
Okay. Very good. Well, with that behind us, open a public hearing on the Section 126605 sign language. Permitted signs. I think that the changes we asked for have been made. And all those deletions stand. Any discussion on this?
Right. All this does is reorganize. It doesn't alter any regulations.
That's correct.
Regarding signs. It just makes it a lot easier to understand what's allowed and what's not allowed.
That was a very concise summary. Any other comments? Any comments from the public? No. All right, with that, any further discussion? We have a motion to accept these changes.
Do we need to close the public hearing?
Yes, we do, actually. Thank you. You're welcome for that.
That would be great, actually.
No, I just don't want
to get rid of it.
Don't die.
I just don't want to think of that.
So there's no further discussion. We'll close the public hearing. Do we have a motion to accept these changes and present them to council?
So moved.
Second?
I second it.
You want to voice vote?
We can certainly do that.
Sure.
Oh, do you need a roll call?
Yes, roll call. Sorry.
Oh, there we go. Asplund. Yes.
Stiles.
Yes.
Hozell.
Yes.
Abraham.
Yes. Yes.
All right.
Okay, so that is it for the public hearings. Our old business is an update on the 423 West Limestone Street conditional use application.
Yes.
Please, do you want to?
Sure. So Anna Haller and I have been communicating via voicemail.
been able to have a conversation yet. She did let me know that she has contacted the original electric contractor, and she's going to be meeting with them very soon to try to resolve the issue. Okay, so that's fine. I also had asked her if she had applied for a home occupation permit, because I did not find one in her file, and she replied that she had applied for all of the permits at the village and county level that she was told to apply for. Her conditional use application that she filled out did say on it that it was a quilting business. However, I don't think that was really brought to light as to what that meant. I think it was more where she was going to have her sewing machine and where it was some storage. However, she's actually going to be having classes. People will be coming for these classes.
Yeah, that goes into conditional use.
I'm going to meet with Donna, and we'll have a fill-up home occupation permit, which will be another conditional use then. And then we'll have to just have that advertised and have a sign put up.
For the home occupation, the neighbors are notified, there's a sign, there's a post. It's a lot different than just an accessory structure.
Yeah.
The process is.
I mean, she hasn't, let me say that she did dispose that.
Yes, yes.
I wanted to make sure that everybody understood.
Oh, yeah, no, I was
the classes.
In fact, the business, I don't think that.
Oh, not the business, that she did.
Yes, I don't think that it wasn't further explored.
And she indicated, because I think it was her daughter.
Yeah.
And she indicated that at a later point, her daughter might even live there, I think.
Yeah.
Which is why the bathroom and kitchen.
She wanted.
Yeah. And so I think, I was thinking making your own quilts, having a quilting business where you're making quilts, that was it.
And selling.
Yeah, maybe not, probably not selling them out of the shop or on a very limited.
Selling at another shop.
Yeah, on eBay or Etsy.
So, I mean, I'll meet with her and, start this process. I mean, it's not, Donna has had a business there, and I know that I've seen her property, but there's plenty of places to park on her property, but we just have to, go back and make sure that we have all this square.
Yeah. Well, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for her, because I know it can feel like, oh, there's this other thing we, there's this.
Oops, yeah. You gotta do this now, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, hopefully she brings a good cheer to the process.
Well, the one thing I found on that, the staff report had said it was RC, and when I was looking through learning the zoning code, yeah, it's a good thing it's not, it's RB, because if it was RC, you're not allowed to even have a home occupation in an accessory dwelling unit in RC. So,
that's a good property.
So she is totally RB. It's just people that have butt against her on Dayton are RC.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's good. So it's not, she can do this, we just have to go through this process.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Denise.
Yeah.
Okay, last item on our agenda is agenda planning. Looks like we get to revisit the accessory structure, or non-conforming lot, rather.
The non-conforming lot, 1282.05, yes.
Can I request that things that, I don't know if this has been done in the past, but things that we vote on that go to council and then get addressed, like, we get an update from staff about, or from Lori, I guess. Because I think that I didn't get to go to the meeting, but did the Antioch Street vacations?
Yes, happen? That all went through. In fact, there used to always be a place for council, report from council on our agenda. Remember those days?
I do.
Yeah.
Would you like to bring them back?
Well, I think it's a good point that Rose brings up, that usually we would go over anything relevant to planning in that and have a report from the the staff update and the planning and the council update.
Right.
So, yeah, we should probably go ahead and put those back on so that we have that as a formalized.
Do you want that right after communications?
I think we used to do it right after review of the minutes, or maybe after communications. Either one, I guess.
Okay, it could either be at the beginning or the end of the meeting, but yeah. I think we did used to do it at the beginning, like after the minutes or...
I mean, it makes sense to do it after the minutes because you might have, like, addressed what, you know, just went through what just went to council.
Discussions were had.
Yeah, so right after the minutes would be a good time for council report. And then we can have a staff report if needed at the end.
Well, let's do it at the beginning.
At the beginning?
Same time.
Possibly do them all at the end, but I'm not sure that's always the best because sometimes there should be information.
Yeah.
Yeah, people leave, or people are alone.
Okay.
So we'll have another conditional use.
Yes.
So the conditional use and the revision of 12205 for next meeting.
So you think Dawn's been ready for the conditional use? Is that what you're thinking?
I'm not concerned.
Okay.
Is it your, just as long as you're all sitting here, if she is not prepared for that October meeting, to go ahead with it in the October meeting and you don't have other items, do you want to hold on the 1282.05 and move to November? Or do you want to just go ahead with your October meeting regardless?
I won't be here for the October meeting.
So what is that here?
Sorry?
What's the date of that meeting?
What is the date? 10th-ish? I can't read it from here.
You need it.
You need bigger calendars.
Big calendars behind us.
12.
Is it 12?
Go ahead.
That's Columbus Day, I won't be here.
I didn't think this.
Indigenous Peoples' Day, depending on.
Right.
Yeah, I guess I'm still scheduled to be here, so. Well, I guess the question is, I would be, I'm always inclined to not have a meeting if it's going to be just like one item.
I agree.
I don't see the point.
Yeah.
So I would say if it's just going to be that one revision, we should not meet. If it's a revision and a conditional use.
I'll call her.
Right, and obviously if there's anything that a citizen has asked.
I'm going to have to meet with her at a different time because she's not available during the time, so I'm here in the office, so.
Okay.
Yeah, unless this code changes some urgent, becomes an urgent matter of, I mean, same thing deal, right? I mean, if somebody needs something, then obviously we should meet, but.
Right, and even so, you've got quite a process of taking it to council and turning it through.
Yeah, so even if it comes an issue.
It's better to resolve.
It won't be resolved even if we, you know, so I would say let's just wait November. Chances are it's not going to come up.
Yeah.
The next month.
Okay, so Judy says we did not elect a chair this year, so that needs to be on the agenda.
Okay.
So start your politicking now.
I think you're willing to stand for this year, 2015.
Can you?
I think that would be great.
I believe you can do nominations.
I hereby nominate Matt to serve as chair for 2015.
Sign this down on the agenda.
And was Tim the, do you need a second person or you just have the one?
Typically, it's just the most senior person this year.
Great.
Everyone seems very happy with it. Do we have a second nomination?
You're doing a wonderful job, so I would like to keep you.
So you're seconding my nomination?
Yes, I second it.
All right, so then we will have a vote on that at our. But 2016 is coming up.
Oh, we can't vote on it now?
No.
No.
Wow.
You don't want to rush into this.
Continue being a rogue commission, no leader, no official leader.
And actually, if we cancel the October meeting, it would be.
Anarchy.
Remember, so.
Whole month.
Right. Mere anarchy is loose upon the planning commission.
Okay, with that, we have nothing left on our agenda. We have a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?
I second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So adjourned.
All right.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice meeting.